Hey everybody, welcome back, Vegas Dice Kings. Alright, today we've got Danny back with us, Ralph Delagatti, Encyclopedia Britannica of Las Vegas. Square biz, dude. You got to see this really cool email we got. Myself, Johnny Law, glad to be here with you guys. Speaking of emails, we got two. You got Vegas Dice Kings at Gmail, 22 Gmail, and then I have my own at AOL, Outlaw Croupier. Croupier is dealer. Outlaw Croupier at AOL for myself. So we got a bunch of good stuff today. We're going to start it off with Danny, my man.
Well, listen, sorry to miss last week, but it was very exciting going back to Atlantic City and Johnny Law and his exploits. I'm telling you, I fell off my chair. And I might have to go to the chiropractor after this. But what I'm
he's a freaking dandy, ain't he, huh?
A dandelion. But I want to talk about some moments I had at Caesar's Palace with the 50-year anniversary and then seeing Benny Higgins after 55, I mean, since 1967 and starting various jobs there, became a dealer, and 55 years later, at the age of, I believe it was 78, he retired and got a limo ride. I got a ride by security off the property when I left, and they said, there's only one number you need to remember, 86.
Right. Hey, Danny, real quick, with regards to Benny being a dealer for 55 years.
Yeah.
I've mentioned before, talking about the business, Ralph's probably said something too. I'm talking about, for example, myself. When I came here at 75, 76, if you wanted a job at Caesar's Palace, you had to wait till somebody died. Nobody quits. And if you were the guy waiting for Benny to die, you never worked at Caesar's. So
that's right. That's
I'm
right.
I'm just saying. You know, very few people. I got my buddy Chip. Ralph and I talked about not too many guys stayed at one joint for their entire career. Very rare, very rare.
No.
But that's a sentiment for Dealer's Palace. So.
Well, and a lot of it was timing, too. I happened to have dealt for 4 years when Murray Ehrenberg was told to go to the Stardust and leave Steve Wynn. He went to the Stardust, and he says, you want to go over there? I said, yeah. And then the sequence of events after 3 months, Tommy Brasha called Murray and said, hey, look, we're putting the first extra board together. And what about Danny Flores? He says, well, he's an excellent dealer. And it was under the guise of they needed one or two Spanish-speaking dealers, since they had, at that time in the 70s, the Latin American countries, these guys were bringing in buku money. And probably half of them were drug dealers, but the flow of cash was insane. So I got hired under that premise, because there was governor's nephews that wanted the job, other high influential people that wanted to. Everyone wanted to work at Caesar's Palace, not necessarily as a crap dealer, but a baccarat dealer, 21 dealer. If you worked as a 21 dealer in the 70s, you were averaging 225, 250 on the weekends every day as a 21 dealer, just pitching them damn cards. And nothing against 21 dealers, but yes, we were table for table as crap dealers there, but we earned it because we worked. Everybody was synchronized. Johnny Law, Ralph will tell you, if the dealers are synchronized and you got this guy not off the reservation and everybody's flowing, it's the greatest thing since soccer.
Going back to Caesar's, what Danny's talking about. So you had other dynamite jobs. Dunes was dynamite. Sands was dynamite. Trop was good. Some of these other joints. But I think that every crap dealer wanted to go to Caesar's Palace. I don't care who, where they work. I think I wouldn't have doubted if a guy at the Sands maybe would have jumped on the opportunity to go over to Caesar's. So you getting in like that, what a great story. And
It was incredible. And I you're absolutely right, Johnny Law, because I wasn't – I remember the first few times that after a while, you know, the guys would go to the elbow room. You remember the elbow room? Yeah. They used to have that little game where you'd hit the thing, right? And I remember this crap dealer. He was a degenerate gambler. He's getting – you know, he went and did a little cocaine in the bathroom and I'm having a good score. I'm beating different guys. So now he wants to bet $50 a game. I said, man, no. And he can't even see straight. I said, no. He says, you better. I bet. Okay. So I took about 400 off of him when he finally said. And I said, and you were hitting the ducks. And I would say, everything's ducky. Because he was, you know, he did that blow. And, you know, he had, it was like a Parkinson moment there. He couldn't hit the broadside of a barn. Go again. Put up another 50. I mean, this guy was hard-headed. And he said, okay.
But back then, after work, because we got cash tips, your pockets were full.
Full.
Every night.
Full. And that's why people say today to me, I'm still working. Why do you come to work almost an hour early? By habit. Because we used to come early. We had time orders, if you whatever shift you work. And I wanted to get acclimated. I knew that it was table for table. It's worth going to work an hour early. Guys, get there. Okay.
Oh, yeah.
I'm working with Ray and Bill. Excellent. Where do you want me? Danny, start the floor. We're going to, you know, there's a few guys. And then every table, it's like Tijuana. There comes Ralph Delagatti, big player, Super George. You know, he usually looking for his guys, but maybe one or two are missing, and the other crew tries to steal him. Then there's a beef when the guys come back. You motherfucker. Oh, excuse me. Sorry, folks. You. Sorry, I thought I was back there for a moment. But those guys got vicious when it came to when it. Folks, I hope you're not sensitive, but believe me, I'm being sensitive. A crap dealer, you couldn't be sensitive and survive. I'm going to tell you more, but these guys got a whole lot more to say right now. And since I've already used some vulgarity, hopefully I'm not penalized by the FCC or the AARRP.
Or the F-U-C-K.
Or the, F-U-C-K. Tell her I'm here at the studio with John Stiles. Okay, take it away.
You only have to remember one number.
Welcome to Professional Performance Magazine Live. Hi, I'm Dr. Jeffrey McGee, and for decades I've had the passion, the curiosity to get inside the minds of super achievers and performers across the globe and visit with them, not from a featurey standpoint. Don't really care what sort of tree you think you are if you were a tree. Don't really care what your favorite ice cream is. What I'm really curious about is, how do successful people think? How do they operate? What drives them? How do they deal with adversity and challenges, as all of us face adversity and challenge? But how do they keep going, and how do they take their dreams and electrify them with passion and bring them to reality? And for decades, I've been the publisher of ProfessionalPerformanceMagazine.com, where each quarter we went out and crossed the globe and gathered about 20 to 30 phenomenal personalities and asked them to share via the printed word their secrets to success, share their mental DNA from which the rest of us could learn. And over the years, we've had the opportunity to do some live video streaming interviews, as well as audio interviews through the years with these personalities as well. And what we're bringing to you here on Professional Performance Magazine Live platform are those interviews, are those words of wisdom from their mouth to your head so you can take action. I'm Jeffrey McGee. Thank you for stopping into our programming, our station, and enjoy.
Hey, we're back. I hope you enjoyed your refreshing break, because we sure did. I'm going to turn it over to either Mr. Delagatti or Johnny Law, and they'll take over. Thank you.
Rob, you got
all
to
right. I thank you. I've got a couple of thank yous I'd like to get across before I get into the other stories. Monty Brand has been really good about some of the notes that he sent me, and I wanted him to know that I appreciate that very much. Carol Doty, Norma Martin, and I got a note from a girl, Nancy DeLillo. She's used to be a Keno girl. She was a showgirl for the Follies Bezier, She's worked here in Vegas since 1974, I believe, 73 or 74. But I was so impressed by the letter that I asked her if it'd be all right if I read it. And she said yes. And so I want to read it to you, and just the quality of her writing and how nice she was about sending it to me. I wanted you to hear it. So I'm going to read it to you. She's answering a question that I sent her, if she watched the show, and this is her answer. Yes, I have watched three of them so far and was gathering my thoughts to write you both. This being the last show she's watched was John and I. I saw both of your emails posted on the screen. There's a lot there. Your main topic, Ralph, containing a personal dedicated collection of presidents and amazing associations with astronauts, are in a class like no one other. Thinking of how your passionate, admiring respect brought you so near to them and brought their energy right to you in Vegas is something a person would only dream about. Enjoy the unique detail you explained surrounding those epic appearances and what you achieved by your sheer good energy and personal drive and organized resources in a few brief words is a pure marvel. When Johnny began the show, he had me laughing at the word juice. As I was new in town in 1974, I had never heard that word before. So many conjugations of one word had me recalling it, laughing. Old school Vegas holds the warmest flame in so many of our hearts. When he declared his love for Vegas as the center of the universe, I knew I was with the right crowd. The distinctive Vegas nostalgia that the three of you gentlemen bring is fresh, fun, and truly entertaining. Now that was something
I love that.
I just...
Che bella.
Yeah, everybody. That's so nice of you, Nancy, and I wanted to thank you on the show. We put the note up, and thanks so much for that. And thank you all, for those of you who have been sending us messages, and we got a couple of emails finally starting to come in. Do more of that. We love hearing from you. Please keep that up. Send us some notes what you think of the show. And if you have any questions, of course, about what we're talking about, please feel free to ask the questions to whoever you're interested in finding it from, and we'll be glad to come right back to you. Now I'm going to get back into my moving to Atlantic City and opening Caesars. We had a lot of trouble in Atlantic City because of the licensing and the Casino Control Commission having so many rules added on to what those that we were used to using in Las Vegas. There was so much more that we had to learn over what to do and what not to do from the Casino Control Commission. And then there's also the Division of Gaming Enforcement, which is the police part of it. We had to deal with their rules as well, and all the things that we couldn't do and say. And the thing about it is, trying to get licensed was the most difficult part. It was a monster. And me, being a man with a vowel at the end of my name, coming from New York, I had a couple of relatives who got in a little bit of trouble. I almost didn't get licensed. I almost had to go back to Las Vegas because everybody else, I came back with a group of five, and four of the guys got licensed right away, and I didn't get licensed till just before, a couple of days before opening. And I wasn't, unless you're licensed, you can't even go in the casino. So I couldn't do much. So I'm putting up a list that my father sent to me. They asked us for every living relative. We had to give them a list of name, address, and telephone number. And I didn't know half of the relatives. A lot of them I didn't know. And so I'm putting this list up that my father wrote for me. It's one page of two large pages of people. And they investigated every one of those people, went to every one of their homes. And besides that, they went to my neighbors where I lived in Las Vegas and questioned them about me. That's how strict they were about before licensing the five of us who came from Las Vegas. Me in particular, because, like I said, my vowel at the end of my name created an extra red flag for them. But they finally licensed me. Hey, Johnny.
Let me ask you something. All of that you went through, so now, right, you stated, and almost everybody did, that was from Vegas, went to Atlantic City after they were in Vegas for a while. 99.9%, everybody came back, everybody ate it. Do you think right up until opening day, all the crap you had to go through, did that kind of like open the door for just how tough it and different it was going to be, or was it just a...
No, because the reason, besides the fact that we were going through that, me in particular was going through that to get licensed, we were already talking to the Casino Control Commission and the Division of Gaming Enforcement about the rules long before we got opened. We met with them. We had to go see them in Newark, and it was just impossible. I mean, one of the things they said is you have to deal... whatever you're going to deal, whether it's on in a single deck, double deck, or shoe, right to the bottom. And I said, you know, and I argued against that. And they said, well, no, you're going to have, that's the way it is. You're going to have to do that. And I said, well, if we do, we're going to end up having to close all the 21 games because it's not, we can't function with that.
That had to be so frustrating.
So, well, you know, they changed all the rules. They made it real tough, so... What I was wanted to anyway, I finally got licensed. But what I wanted to talk about after that is as a joke, we got to be pretty close friends with the top guy in the Casino Control Commission after a while because he respected the patience we had with him. The Division of Gaming Enforcement was kind of tough. But he was trying to work with us, and his name is Mike Santinello, and he was the senior counsel for the Casino Control Commission, and we were working with him, and we at first he was really tough, but then he kind of came around, and we were getting along really well with him. So Larry Wolf was one of the five of us. He came from Reno, and he was one of the five the group that went there to open the place. Sent him this note. I'm going to read it to you. It says, a subject is a new crap game. Through our different discussions, you had indicated an interest in different types of games. Attaches a picture of a craps game that was at one time played at Harold's Club in Reno, Nevada. If you indicate interest in this game, the only problem we have which will need your attention is, does one shooter release both mice, or does each player have one mouse? This is a mouse crap game. Your immediate attention on this matter would be greatly appreciated. Very truly, Larry Wolf, Casino Administrator. And this is the letter he sent back to us. He said, Mr. Larry Wolf, regarding mice craps. Dear Mr. Wolf, in response to your memorandum of January 15, 1980, I think your suggestion of mice craps has distinct possibilities for Atlantic City casinos. As you realize, of course, now here's where it becomes the usual. As you realize, of course, the mice will have to be licensed as casino employees and thoroughly investigated by the Division of Gaming Enforcement. I suggest, therefore, that you pre-screen each mouse carefully, since any mouse having a criminal background will be disqualified. I should also note that each crap table will have to maintain a staffing ratio of 6 mice per table during peak season and 4 mice per table during non-peak season. For staffing purposes, it will be assumed that each mouse will work an hour on and 20 minutes off, 9 to 10 hours a day, 5 to 6 days a week. Any mouse going off the table during play must, of course, be retrieved and inspected before being replaced on the table to assure that a player hasn't switched mice. I would suggest that you petition the commission for an amendment to your Section 99 submission permitting mice traps and supply the necessary work permits for them. You may also want to suggest an appropriate position to be placed on their licenses. Sincerely, Mike Santinella, Deputy Director.
Oh, my God.
Everybody's late.
That's
so
funny.
He was going along with the joke about how strict they were and all the rules they had. And I thought you guys would get a kick
That's
out of
that. That's pretty good. That's really, about that was really that. Good. Do they still strict?
Oh, yeah.
Even today?
Well, they are with Las Vegas people for some reason. I don't know. They're not that bad with New Jersey residents. I know that. They were easy to get licensed and the dealers as dealers. But they really, well, they did a job on me. Like, I was up to, I think it was 2 days before the opening, before they got my, I was ready to go back to Las Vegas.
Wow.
You know, the other guys got licensed, you know, a couple of months, and they got, I went almost 6 months before they licensed me.
You had to be frustrated, right?
Why did they give you the stall?
I mean, I was busy working, doing what I had to do pre-opening, but at opening, I was going to be out of the picture. I would have to go back. And they, because I had some relatives in New York that had gotten a little bit of trouble, and they made a big thing about it. Well, yeah, he's so anyway, that's a funny story about it. And we managed to loosen him, those people, the commission, up a little bit. But the Division of Gaming Enforcement, the police part of it, those are the guys who did the investigating and went to our houses, our neighbors, and every one of our living relatives. And I mean, they went to their houses, knocked on the door. It was amazing how thorough they were.
Wow.
Okay, so after a while we got Caesars Boardwalk HZ open, and it was very successful. It was doing very well. And Terry Lanny, the president, who I'd befriended while we were working there, I made a bet with him about getting all the work done that had to be done prior to the opening that I was responsible for. And he said, I'll bet you dinner you don't do it. And I said, okay. So anyway, I won the bet, and we went out and had dinner together. So we got to be pretty good friends. He called me into his office after we'd been open about a year, I guess, maybe not quite. I think it was about a year. And he said, we're having a serious problem with our Caesars World office in Philadelphia. Now, the Caesars World office represented Caesars Boardwalk Regency, but Caesars in Las Vegas and Caesars in Lake Tahoe as well. And he said, with their $17 million we can't collect, we're about to write it off. He said, I'm not sure whether we can write off that much because there's so much to write off. They only allow you a certain percentage to write off. He said, the office is in a shambles. He said, you know so many of the players in Philadelphia are better players. Would you mind taking it over? And I said, yeah. I said, but I don't have a car yet that I, you know, I'm going to have to commute. It's 65 miles. I'm going to have to commute. I don't have a car. He said, well, I just got a new Eldorado. And he said, I'm going to give you that Eldorado to drive. He said, so if I give that to you, will you do this for us, for the company, because we think you can get a lot of it fixed up. So I said, okay. So he gave me the Eldorado. And you know, one of the reasons I left New York and went to California was the fact that I learned what it was like to have to commute to go to work on a train and take an hour and a half each way. I wasted 3 hours a day commuting, and that was one of the things I said, I'll never do this. If I ever had a family, I wouldn't waste 3 hours going and coming to work. I'd rather be with my family. And now here I am commuting to Philadelphia, wasting well over an hour each way, 65 miles, traffic. And so I wasn't very happy about that, but I did it because Terry Lanny was so nice about it and asked me to do the favor.
How long do you have to do that for, Rob?
Okay, and that's okay. That I'm going to explain that part of it. So now I go there, and I'm there I get the office under control. I had a couple of secretaries that I hired that to help with all of the paperwork and the mailings, because I was, you know, they do mailings to Lake Tahoe. You bring junkets. They wanted me to do junkets because I was junket licensed. Nobody else was. Nobody in Atlantic City got a license except me. Isn't that strange? They didn't want to give me a license, and then all of a sudden I was the only guy that would give a junket license because of the experience I had at the dunes and at the land.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
I can't believe it.
So anyway, so there was a lot of work to getting that organized. When I got that thing, I knew a lot of people in Philadelphia, and I asked them, some of them knew some of the other people that owed money, and I asked them to help me out with that. I ended up collecting almost 15 of the 17 million, believe it or not.
Wow.
In a year's time. And then, now Tara Lanny, in the meantime, had left Caesars and went back to Las Vegas to open up the MGM.
Okay.
And he worked there for a long time. And a new guy come in, I'm not going to mention his name. And so he calls me after I've been there about a year, and I had all this done. The office was in good shape. We had a group to Lake Tahoe. I'll tell you about that a little later. That was a great success, a junket group. So everything was going very well. And he calls me up to his office, and I have a meeting in Atlantic City. So I went there, and he said, we want you to open up 5 offices for Caesars World all around the Philadelphia area. You pick the spots wherever you think another office should be. And Philadelphia is a big area, and it would justify 5 offices. There are certain areas all in and around the city that would could do very well for Caesars if you had an office there. So I said, I think I can do that. He said, you pick the building where you choose the office, your location, you hire the people and train them, you do the furnishing, you do everything. He said, get the whole thing set up. He said, you do those 5. So I said, okay, and I waited till he was finished, and then I said, okay, now, what about me? I said, if a casino has money they can't collect, there are people, there are collection agencies who charge 10 or 15% to collect it, if they can. Now, if they collected 15 million, that's, if it's only 10%, it's a million and a half.
Pretty good commission.
Yeah. So I said, what about me? I mean, I collected all that money. I've got the office. I said, is there a bonus? Is there a raise in my salary? As he said, no, you wait. After you get all the offices open, we'll talk again. So that's like at least another year away, before I could do all that. Maybe. I mean, what kind of work that is to have to go through all, to pick the locations, to furnish them, to do everything. So I said, now in the meantime, the Playboy, the president of Playboy, they were getting ready to open in Atlantic City, not far from Caesars, and the president had called me up twice and asked me if I would be interested in going there as director of casino marketing. He said he had heard about me and all the clients that I knew and this and that. So I said, no, I said, I'm with Caesars. I'm going to stay with Caesars. They've been very good to me. Caesars had put me on a special bonus plan and everything, and they were going to take care of me, salary-wise. They didn't raise my salary, but they put me in with the bonuses. Which was not that much. I don't remember what it was. But anyway, so I told him no. And then I had the meeting with this guy, and he said, when you get the offices all open, then we'll talk again. So I said, do you realize you're talking, you expect me to do all this? It's going to take me at least a year, maybe more. And I have to go along the way I am now with nothing in return from... And he said, that's right. He said, when you get done, we'll talk. So I said, okay. And I called the president of Playboy. I told him that I would talk to him. If he could meet my demands, I would make the change. I met with him. He said, whatever you want. I told him what I wanted. You got it. So I signed the papers, and I went to work. And I resigned from Caesars, which I really broke my heart because I loved working for Caesars. And and I went to Playboy. But when they heard about the resignation, one of the Perlman brothers, one of the owners, Stuart Perlman, he called me up on the phone. He said, "Ralph, what are you doing?" I said, "Well, I told him what happened. I wasn't going to hold it back. You know, I didn't believe in going past anybody's head. I figured if this guy told me you have to wait till you're finished, I figured he knew what he was talking about. So I never went to one of the owners." He said, "Why didn't you come to me?" And I explained to him why. And he said, "Well, forget it." He said, "Forget about it." He said, "You tell me what you want. We'll fix you up, and you're staying with us." And I said, "I've already, you know, made a deal with Playboy. I've signed the papers, an agreement with them, and I have to go. I'm not going to them." He said, "The hell with Playboy. You're not coming with me." "No," I said, "I can't do it." So I left Caesars, and I went to Playboy. So we're going to get to Playboy next week and talk about what happens. There's some amazing stuff with Hugh Hefner and the bunnies and the show, the centerfolds, and you'll get a kick out of that. But that's how I left Caesars. I couldn't tolerate the fact that he said, "Well, when you finish, then we'll talk about it." I thought that I deserved a little more consideration than that.
When it was all said and done, you comfortable that you did that?
Well, I would have been, but what happened is, as luck would have it, John, I went to Playboy. I got that open. We had a huge success. I brought championship fights. I signed a deal with Bob Arum, and I brought championship fights back to Atlantic City, which they used to have in the 30s and 40s. And so I made a deal with CBS and Bob Arum, and brought championship fights to Playboy, and we'll talk about that, and I'll show you some of that. But I even got the Olympics to have pre-Olympic games like Germany against the U.S., which they do in other areas, and I said, "I want some," and everybody said, "You know, Playboy, they'll never do it to Playboy." I got them, and that was a good thing. It was just like having the fights. You sent out invitations, and a lot of people came to see the Olympics, you know, like that.
Good stuff.
The competition. So, you know, I did a lot of stuff for Playboy. I started having these shows, these events with 10 centerfolds. I thought maybe it would be interesting, because Playboy was really hot stuff. This is 1980-81. It was, you know, all over the country. There was Playboy clubs everywhere and all of that. So I figured if I get 10 centerfolds and we have dinners with them, and they sit and have dinner with the VIPs and take pictures and dance with them and do all that stuff, it might be a good attraction. Well, let me tell you, we got all of our top players whenever we had one. They all came with their wives, some of them, but some of them without, just to get around those centerfolds. Right. It was really something. But anyway, I'll get back to that later. But the point that I'm trying to make is, 1 year after we got open, Playboy lost their license. The Division of Gaming Enforcement found out that they had paid off some politicians in Nassau, Bahamas, because they had a Playboy casino there. They paid off some politicians there, and because they found that out, they took their license away from them and closed it up. So this new group of people came in, and they started changing everything. I had just signed a new contract with Bob Arum. They wouldn't honor the contract. So I sent in a letter of resignation, and I had to resign. Now I was out of work. You know?
Wow.
Yeah. So I was sending people to Monte Carlo. Some friends of mine, some clients of mine, wanted to know if I knew anybody in Monte Carlo, and I knew a girl who ran the Monte Carlo office. I knew her husband, so I called her once in a while, and I'd send her clients. So, and she had asked me, "If you ever want to, you know, work for us and send groups of people to Monte Carlo, let me know." So I called her up, and she said, "Absolutely. You know, every 6 weeks you put a group together. You can go to Monte Carlo. It'll be first class. We'll spend 3 days in either Rome, London, Madrid, or Paris.
Wow.
And then 6 days in Monte Carlo, all expenses paid, first class airfare for all of your clients." So I said, you got me, you know. So that's what I did for 18 months, and then I went to work at the resorts. But that was something, every 6 weeks to take a group
wow.
of people. All, and I was the host, and I went with them. I gambled just as much as some of them, though. and it was fantastic. I mean, I loved it. It was real. I loved Monte Carlo. It was a wonderful place.
So, did you see Prince Rainier?
Actually, yes, I did. I saw him, but I shook hands with Grace Kelly. She had one of the times I went there with our group. They had some kind of ball that she threw every year or two, where all the swells from all over Europe would come. The women wore it. You should see the jewelry. It was kings and queens and all right. kinds of people like that. Ugh. You know, counts and all of that stuff. And my group was invited to it, and we were on. They lined up. They lined some of us up, and I was part of the people that they lined up. And she came up the line and shook hands with each one of us. And she said to me, she said, "I hear you're an American. You're from America." She said, "I love meeting my fellow Americans." And she said, "I hope you know. I hope you have a nice time." And I said, "Thank you. It's such a pleasure to meet you and everything."
Very cool.
And there was some kind of the Rose Bowl. No, it wasn't the Rose Bowl. I don't remember. But I'll get into that later.
It says a lot for her too.
Oh yeah.
She
was. It wasn't just passing time. She was really sincere about the fact that she enjoyed, greeting Americans.
So. How did she look in person?
She's beautiful at that time. Yeah, she was an absolutely beautiful woman, and she shone, She was really, really nice.
So, I gotta say it. So, speaking about beautiful women, I remember the movie 10 had only been out for a while.
Oh, God.
Bo Derek. And she sat down on my game.
Are you kidding? She did?
Yeah.
Bo Derek.
Oh, and I'm going to tell you what. All right. This is and I've seen a lot of beautiful women
gorgeous.
In my life.
Stunning.
When I looked at her, it was almost like it wasn't human. It was something different.
Yeah.
So, I never forgot that. And I remember actually kind of like doing research of how somebody can look a million times better than every person in the world. I just couldn't stop looking at her. I'm doing everything I can to look at her face. I could not believe it about how beautiful she was.
I can verify that because when her husband was alive, John Derek, the actor, they would come into Caesars. Yes, he was. He was real down to earth. And she was absolutely gorgeous. They came by the crap table and were talking to the pit boss or something, and I'm just mesmerized. I'm trying to get the scent of her cologne. I don't know what it could have been, but it must have been fabulous.
Good. Unbelievable.
I'm going to finish up on this, and but I just there's a letter that Caesars put out when I took over the Philadelphia office that we're going to show talk. It was a kind of letter that sent to all the clients that I was moving from working in Atlantic City to running the Caesars World office in Philadelphia. And then there's another invitational letter that I put out when I was there for the junket to go to Caesars in Lake Tahoe, which was quite a trip for people from Philadelphia to get to go to Lake Tahoe and visit Lake Tahoe when the weather was good. And we had a yacht there, and they got to ride out on the yacht on the lake, and it was a really great, it was a big success. That's pretty much it. There was one other thing. We had invitations to, this is a story. They were having a fight, and Caesar's Palace was putting on a fight, and they had built like a stadium, an open air stadium in the back, and they were having the Muhammad Ali, Larry Holmes heavyweight championship fight there. And so they asked me to bring some of our best clients, and they would give them ringside seats. And of course they gave two seats to me to join them, to be with them like I was hosting them. And So I got a nice group of people, and we were right at ringside. I had two seats, my wife and I at the time, and I got two seats for my two of my oldest sons were sitting way up in the nosebleeds, but at least they were there, and this was a thrill for them. So before the main event came, I left and I went up to the top to see the boys, and I was stunned to see Sugar Ray Robinson and his wife sitting in the row behind where my two boys were, way up in the top bleachers in the nosebleeds.
Wow.
And so I went up to him and I shook hands with him, and I said, would you do me a favor? And he said, what? I said, I've got two seats at ringside, and these are my sons. I'd rather sit where they are. Would you mind taking the seats that I have? And he looked at his wife, and he went, look what this man. I said, Ray, you don't belong up here.
Right.
You belong ringside. Who the hell put you up here? And I escorted him downstairs. I put him in the seats where we were. There was all kinds of Hollywood celebrities and all the big, that's where everybody was. And the minute he was crying, the minute we got there, there was tears coming out of him. And everybody's saying, hey, Ray, you know, nice to see us, you know, where it's where he would belong. And I walked away, and he was, you know, he wanted to talk, and I left him like,
what an embarrassment that
Sugar Ray Robinson
had to feel because of.
Can
what
you
happened?
Imagine?
He was one of the great fighters of all time.
Without a doubt, and who the hell would be dumb enough? It's better you didn't give him anything than
exactly.
To stick him way up there like that, you know. So anyway, that's the end of my stories, but I thought you'd be find it interesting.
It
about
is. Like putting Joe Louis up there. You got
exactly the same thing, yeah. So and he had tears running down his face when we got there, you know.
But that's great that when you did such a great gesture and the crowd acknowledged, they knew who he was.
Oh, well, everybody knew him, and they were saying, great, you know, like he belonged there. That's where, you know, everybody was saying, you know, they were all to have. He looked at me, and, you know, I was already on my way upstairs. But.
So, Ralph, all of this stuff that you've done, all these people and all this other stuff, the fact that you see him with a tear in his eye was, you know.
The hell with the seat.
In your memory.
The hell with the seat. I'm telling a story about it 50 years later.
You know,
40 years later, whatever it was. No, that meant a lot. Well, you know how it is when you give. It's better to give when you give to somebody that really deserves it, and it really touches them somehow. There's nothing better, you know. So you're right about that. So
that's something that you could never forget.
So anyway, we're going to take a little break, and then we're going to turn it over to John. And thanks for listening. Thanks for joining with us. We'll be back in a minute.
Hello, folks. This is Mac Jackson Jr. from Vanderson Cyber Group. The problem with businesses today is that they are affected by cyber attacks from around the world, but companies are not sure of what to do. Normally, they are reactive instead of proactive. But folks, cyber attacks can affect your bottom line, and it will affect you financially, legally, and your business reputation. Here at Vanderson Cyber Group, we can help you develop a policy by training your employees on what to do if they are involved in a cyber attack and how to mitigate it and fight against it. Folks, we call it here #StayCyberWoke. And that's Vanderson Cyber Group here in Las Vegas and around the world. You can reach me, folks, at VandersonCyberGroup.com or my website, MacJacksonJrJr.com as well. Here locally, 702-868-0808. Give us a call today, folks. We must fight back.
Hey, welcome back. Hey, today, I'll say a couple things on what Ralph talked about. And today, though, I'm going to talk about something other than the usual stories of in the pit and stuff.
John, I got in. Can I interrupt for 1 second? I just want you to see the letterhead, John's letterhead. Outlaw. Don't you love that letter? I think that's sensational.
So Outlaw was my nickname since fourth grade, racking balls in the pool room. When I changed my name in 76 to John Law, the middle name was going to be Out. Luckily, I'm glad I didn't do it. But Outlaw, I played softball 27 years in town. Softball tournaments, Johnny Law's Outlaws. Everything was Outlaws. Every team of my kids, they were the Outlaws. They're little t-ball, soccer.
Oh, that's cute.
Everything.
That's cute.
Everything was Outlaws.
That's a great name for a little kid.
Glad you said that. Everybody, those of you who know me know exactly what I'm talking about. I got all my friends that, you know, I talk about, all the other crap dealers, all these parties I did. Probably everybody has 20, 30 different Outlaw shirts. Because we did softball tournaments at Bally's for 20 years. So we had a lot of fun. Anyways, real quick though, Ralph mentioned Tahoe. That ring a bell for me. And I think it was about 78, 79, Braniff Airlines opened up and they were giving Tahoe $1 round trip.
Braniff, and, yes.
Yeah, yeah, $1 round trip.
I remember that.
From,
so, here,
from Vegas to...
Yeah, Vegas to Reno.
Wow, about that. Right.
And I remember I had a big five-man, the old wooden toboggan. I said, they got back and forth. And we would go up to Heavenly and ski and sled ride there. Probably the coolest place in Tahoe was a place called Jason's Hot Tubs, right on Ski Run Boulevard. It was like spring fever was, whoa, but with no roof. Wow. So you would go into, you would pay by the hour, and you would go into a room with a hot tub, all redwood, but it was open. And the snow would be falling while you're in the hot tub with a girl drinking champagne. It was dynamite. One of my favorite places over the years. So there was just nothing cool about Las Vegas. Like I said, this week what I want to talk about is my passion for Las Vegas. All right? I've done a lot of thinking about stuff. And those of you who live here don't get around... Red Rock Canyon. I've just been thinking about Red Rock, the loop out there. I always have friends in from Florida, and when they go out there, Red Rock is the opposite of Florida. And I mean, people are amazed. So I just want to throw out there, if you come to visit Las Vegas, you hear about Red Rock, take a ride out to Red Rock Canyon. They do. That's where Super Summer Theater is. The plays I talk about out there. Mount Charleston, since the leg thing, I don't go much there anymore because I can't get around in the snow or anything. But Mount Charleston, I don't know if they already are. You have to use a trolley or something now, or a shuttle. I heard they're closing up because there's so many people. But other things, Rogers Springs, I want to talk about Valley of Fire, Warm Springs out by Moapa. Do you remember there was a place out by Moapa, Warm Springs?
Springs had two pools. It was owned by the Petersons. They had the Peterson, one main pool with the
gravel.
They had the gravel on the bottom and the one big pool with palm trees all the way around. And then the other pool, they had a big pool. Then they had a little pool with the stream.
So they had a stream coming down through the property. And every picnic table was right on this little stream. And the kids loved it. Oh. I heard that something up there is open up again, though. So maybe by next week I'm going to take a ride up there and take a look at it, all right? So those are the places on the outside. I got thinking about this week, talk about it in a second, but the venues, how Las Vegas is just different and special. I would like to lead to how these venues change overnight. The big thing I'm going to talk about was last week, even this week. So at the Allegiant Stadium, Saturday we had a Rebel game. Sunday was the Raider game, Black Sunday. But what I'm talking about is, so now I'm in this stadium with the UNLV. The field is down there. It's artificial turf. Come back for the Raider game. Now the field is level. It's that big, giant grass field that they roll in and out. And what I'm talking about is, so this week at so the first time, what I'm talking about is at the Stones concert, all right? The place was packed, and I'm going to show you a few photos of the before and the after the Stones concert, how much smoke is in this arena, because there's old people like me smoking pot there. Everybody was smoking pot at the Stones concert. Wow. But what I'm saying is how this venue and these people change. I remember at the Stones concert, so it was done, you know, they're starting to close down. And I remember before I went to Punchada, went over and I sat there, and it was like little worker ants coming. Now, the Stones had two 10-story big giant screens, and all these people, boom, boom, boom. Within 20 minutes, there were 12 semi-trucks, and they're moving us in. So what I'm talking about is, well, even last week, we had two concerts. So last week, on Saturday, was Motley Crue, Def Leppard and stuff. Next day was Imagine Dragons. 8,000 seats on the floor. They had to take them all out to clean it up and put them all back the next day. So I'm saying this as a testimonial to the old stagehands and especially the musicians in Las Vegas. When we lost the musicians, everybody felt that. Everybody. Because these musicians were just dynamite people. And what I liked about it, we had the old musicians union on Koval there. And you would go in every night. They'd come in. Some nights you'd see two, three guys. One night you'd have an orchestra, 50-cent drinks and stuff like that. So what I'm talking about is Las Vegas, how Las Vegas can turn into a Grand Prix race in one day, and the next day it's something different. These stadiums. Another.
One thing I want to mention is that, you know, in the older, the 50s, 60s, the lounge shows were everything, and they were inexpensive. And the musicians were first rate. And then in the 80s or 90s, they started going to tape music, which...
It was brutal.
Oh, my God. That's...
Yeah. So anyways, I that's what got me thinking about all this. So another one was several months ago, we had Metallica one day, and then we had Billy Joel the next day. And it's the same, it was the same people, because Billy Joel, our age, you know, 60s, 70s, 80s, even Metallica, and you saw all these hardcore rockers, and I just thought it was great. But going back to the Rebels, I gotta say, Rebels win 58-27. Rebels haven't scored 58 points in the 50 years I've been here, so... UNLV is dynamite. It was dynamite. Talking about UNLV, I had mentioned my daughter, Lindsay, when she was 5. She was a cheerleader there. And luckily, that was when we won NCAA. And the cheerleaders traveled with the team, so I got to go all the way to the Final Four and watch everything because my daughter was a little cheerleader. And they still have them girls. That's why I was thinking about that at halftime at the UNLV game. And back in 90, you remember Phil the Fixer, right? A little bit, the famous hot tub scene.
That was actually Richie
Stacey
the Fixer.
Stacey Ogman and Larry Johnson.
Richie
that's
the Fixer.
Richie, yeah, right. Yeah. I got that picture. I don't know if I can find it, but I got these other pictures of the stadiums that I wanted to talk about real quick. Also, with regards to events. This weekend, I don't know why they're doing them both together, San Gennaro and Greek Food Festival. They're probably the two most popular kind of things like that based on food. Why they're doing them the same weekend, it doesn't make sense. Now, I went to the first San Gennaro at the Italian Club on East Sahara where the Kmart was, right? I went to the first one. I remember drinks were 25 cents. The food was dynamite. And it was in that little parking lot at the Italian Club.
Yeah.
Italian Club is still a great evening out if you want to go.
Yeah.
But, and great Greek food festival. I worked at Sahara 88-182 by chance at great food festival was up in the convention area at the Sahara. So they're coming this weekend. If I had to pick one, it'll be the Greek Food Festival. San Gennaro way outpriced herself. It's like $10, $12 just to get in the gate. Dinners are $15, $20 and stuff. A beer is $4, $5 now. And, you know, it didn't used to be like that. I'm not preaching old Vegas, you know, in the past. It's just that's the way it is. So luckily, the San Gennaro starts on Wednesday, Thursday in the weekend. Greek Food Festival is Friday, Saturday, Sunday. So if you can't go to both, go to at least one. San Gennaro's out at the M this time, out the South Strip down there. But the greatest of all, El Dorado, right? El Dorado was a big, big thing in Vegas. Everybody was involved. Every dealer in town were Western.
Yes.
Except the Horseshoe Crab dealers. Horseshoe Crab dealers, dress pants, man. That's it. We were the upper echelon of dealers. But everybody used to wear, right, shirts that have jails. You'd go into jail. You know, you grew a beard and stuff like that. El Dorado, they still do it, but it's nothing like it used to be. El Dorado was, to this day, probably one of the greatest events that we've done.
And don't forget, go ahead.
Do they still have floats when they do it now? Because they used to have, every hotel used to have a float.
Right.
Every hotel had a big float full of showgirls, and it was amazing.
And there were big parades.
It was a big parade.
Look, if you see a root beer float. But I also remember as a kid when they used to have the deer contest, and everyone would bring their cars with deers on their cars to the front of the Golden Nugget downtown, because I'd go with my dad, and there's all these hundreds of cars, and they got deers all over the place, and the guys out there measuring the points on the antlers.
I never heard of that one before.
Oh, yes. It's a true story.
Hey, Fremont Street, down where the experience is, like I told you, when I had my convertible Cadillac, I parked my car on Fremont Street, and the crap table's right there.
Yeah.
So you go out there, we're sitting in the car smoking a joint on Fremont Street.
Yeah.
There's my bosses right there. They don't give a shit. Like I said, Teddy built a room for us to smoke pot downstairs. So Las Vegas is dynamite.
And Teddy would be really tickled that they're going to open up pot lounges now. They should name it after Teddy Pena.
Yeah, all right. The Teddy Room, all right?
Exactly.
Yeah, I'm going to look into that. All
please
right?
do.
Anyways, going back to Black Sunday with the Raiders, I'm going to tell you what. You couldn't have choreographed. I mean, it's that down to the last second. It seemed like the clock was stuck on 30 seconds forever. You know, what's going on? What's going on? And then the OT, we thought we had it locked up. So at the stadium, I finally found my spot. So I'm in a VIP, and I work at the bottom of the escalator, which means I see every VIP come down, get to talk to. And I'll tell you what, there's a lot of old school Vegans, Las Vegans that... like just on Sunday that come by and we talked. I told them about the show and stuff. So hopefully I'll start getting a bunch of stories from some of these people there that the upper echelon of Las Vegas. There's a lot of good people there. So what was cool was Carlos Santana for National Anthem. He did. His wife played drums, and he played guitar, the old Jimi Hendrix National Anthem, and it was dynamite.
Wow.
And his wife did, I mean, she's like Gene Krupa on the drums. I mean, if you can, look at the video, National Anthem, Carlos Santana on the game Sunday. Worth watching. It was kind of cool. So, anyways, that's about it. The Aces.
Yes.
I'm going to tell you what. Hey, I went to a women's game a couple months ago or so. The best $10 in Vegas by far. These girl basketball games. So I had my two, Scott and Douglas were here from my hometown. Since I've taken a couple other people like me, we hated going to NBA. you hated the NBA players because they're not real nice in the casino, you know. We could do without them. But I'll tell you what, the Aces games are a ton of fun. They are the first team, professional team in Las Vegas to win a world title. These girls are dynamite, and they're going to be like this for about 10 years before they even slow down.
Congratulations. So, everybody's congratulations proud of you. Absolutely. Proud of the Aces. Yes, absolutely.
Yes, absolutely.
All right, good job, girls. Very proud of you. Very proud of you.
So, I'm going to get a tattoo.
Right. All right, so you know what? I'm going to go ahead and wrap it up. We'll be back next week. Danny has some stories. Ralph will talk about the Playboy. And I got a little bit to add for that, so we'll see.
I want to mention one thing. I want to say hello to all my Western High School alumni. We'll see you October 14th on our what would have been our 50-year reunion, but now it's 52. And you know.
Good job.
It's going to be great.
It's not I just did my 50th and was probably the best one we ever had.
You know.
There's one thing that you reminded me of when you talked about parking your car. A couple of days ago, I was in messing around with Facebook. I enjoy putting stuff up on Facebook. And I read one of the Facebook things was talking about old Las Vegas, and they said, what do you remember most, or what do you miss most? That's what it was. What do you miss most about old Las Vegas? So you go on and on about, but I was being a wise guy, and I said, in the old days, I used to park in the parking lot of any one of the casinos and could walk right in the front door. It was, you know, maybe 20, 30 feet, 40 feet away, and walk into the casino. And I was never charged anything. And now you have to walk half a mile after you park, and they charge you to go risk losing your bankroll. And I just, that's
it
what
doesn't
I,
make sense.
They charge you to go in and risk losing your money. I don't understand whose idea that was and how desperate they had to be to do that, but it doesn't make sense to me. I'm an old timer, I'm sorry, but.
Well, that's all part of what I spoke about a couple of weeks ago. They chip away at this. We got rid of the Christmas party. Got rid of Wet n' Wild. They don't even give you a turkey on Thanksgiving. They take away this, take away that.
$35.
And these big bosses, they're the ones that have the balls to do it. But then they make all this money. You know, they're making $200 million. Yeah. You know, and these janitors and maids, you know, they're the true hardbone backbone of Las Vegas. So anyways, one last thing for parking. McCarran Airport, where you drop people off now at McCarran, I used to park there, fly to L.A. for 2 days, 3 days, come back. Your car's right there.
That's right.
I mean, it was dynamite. Yeah. Oh, so, anyways, that's about it for this week. Hey, any of you guys have any thing you want to do with video or anything like that? We're going to start talking more about my producer, John Stiles, very, very talented man. If you're watching this...
He's taking bows,
he's taking
folks.
Bows
he's taking
back
bows back
there. Don't watch any of his stuff. He's a lumpy.
He should be in charge of Disney.
He's a producer.
That's right.
Pixar. Pixar. Because he can create some stuff.
He is a creator. He's really great at it.
He's
really good at it.
All right, check everything out. You know, what the hell else you
got
to do?
And look at his shows, folks. He's got shows for days.
Yeah, yeah.
And nights. And incredible.
Yeah, double exposure. They're all done.
Incredible things. Unbelievable. Wrap it up.
Okay.
All right. Hey, we'll see you next week.
See you next week.
Thank you.
Keep smiling.
Thanks for joining us.
Keep rolling them bones.
Bye-bye.